It's the Opie and Anthony Show in studio, Jeffery Ross and Ken Burns.
Yes. No, you don't have headphones? Why would you?
He can't hear. Ken Burns cannot hear.
Ken Burns can't hear. Are you insane?
All the music, the voices. All right. Is that better?
I'll turn down the music then. How's that?
Nothing?
Nothing.
Why?
Oh, we're looking stupid in front of Ken Burns.
No.
God. He's going to do a documentary on awful radio shows next.
Yeah, right. We'll be prominently featured. Yeah, ears.
Oh, my God.
Comes in and points to the ears. No.
Oh,
you don't have to fix his iPhones.
Oh,
what
my
are you
God.
Doing?
If it's a comedian or an actor, who cares? But it's a documentary filmmaker.
This guy's a respected documentary filmmaker. That's it. There we go. Okay. Ken Burns. The War... I watched it. Fantastic. When I heard your name attached to it, I was like, this is great. The Civil War was amazing. I know people have, over the years just given you much praise on that. And I think it's because I've seen a lot of documentaries on the Civil War and World War II, but you've taken that personal angle. You take people's stories and incorporate it into it instead of just showing it for what it is. Where did you get that idea from? Was it somebody, were you inspired by somebody, or you just thought that would...
There have been thousands of documentaries on the Second mm-hmm. World War. You know, we actually do not need another documentary on the Second World War because there have been so many, but they're all distracted by a kind of a top-down view that focuses on celebrity generals and politicians, on strategy and tactics, on weapons and armament, all things Nazis, nothing else.
Mm-hmm.
And we thought, we're losing 1,000 veterans a day. You know, the war touched every family on every street in every town in America. So there's that effect is still going on right now. And so we thought if we did a bottom-up story, we took four, darts on a map, four geographically distributed towns, found out how they lived, what they did, and then sent their men off to war, interested not in the good war that World War II has become, but the real war, what was it like to be in combat. You'd touch on something that was critical to it, and the response has been, unbelievable.
It's amazing because rarely in a documentary do you get so attached to, and I hate to use the word characters because these are real people. You'll start a story out talking about a son that goes off to war, writing letters back home. The narrative will read the letters. And you don't know what's going to happen to this person. And then when you find out that the telegram came or the clergy comes to the door, it's devastating
for
the viewer.
It's absolutely true. We sort of paid lip service while we were working on it that the people that we would populate the film with would be so-called ordinary people that you get to know them like somebody you might have had Thanksgiving with.
Mm-hmm.
But that's exactly what's happened. You know, when you deal with folks that aren't boldface names, when you deal with not a top-down but a bottom-up version, these people become part of life. And I remember I was screening the film just before it was completely done, before it was broadcast, a whole bunch of warm bodies just to see what their response was. And after the fifth episode, where one of our fighter pilots had a really tough time, and he wrote his girlfriend, I live in a world of death. It's really tough. I meet out at the drinking fountain, and she shakes her head. She goes, whoa. And I said, yeah, it's tough. Middle-aged woman. She goes, listen, you can tell me. Does he make it? Now, she's been watching this guy's interview.
Mm-hmm.
She's been watching this guy, he's clearly alive. He's 80 years old.
Yeah.
And I said, but you've seen him. And she goes, oh, yes, of course. But she was so in the moment.
Yeah, she was.
And, that's the essence. I think, most of us, history is like castor oil. It's homework. It's not good tasting. But if it's really working, you tune in because you're not so sure it's going to turn out the way you already know it did.
Mm-hmm.
I think you took lemons and made lemonade with that woman. She was a dope.
Yeah, right. I loved it, though. I thought we were home free. I went back in. I told all the other producers. I said, man, we've done it. Because if you're sitting there and you're so anxious that somebody that you see as an 80-year-old man may not make it through because you've so gotten into the story... I thought this is good.
That seems to be a problem with people. I think you look at the 80-year-old man, and you're so set apart from what he was and what that time was.
That's right.
That you really can't relate to it.
Exactly.
Enough time has passed where you're like, all right, here's this young guy. He's just a kid. He's going off to the greatest war in the history of the planet. But you just, it's too far away. It's black and white. It's, yeah. it's right. And the same thing happened with the Civil War documentary. It was, that's so long ago that it's unrelatable. But your documentaries bring these people to life, make them so relatable to the people you know, your friends, that's the people you have known.
That's our whole effort, which is the great arrogance of the present, is that we think that somehow because we've survived, we know more, we're cooler, we're more sophisticated, we think better thoughts. And every 18-year-old, 19-year-old, 20-year-old, and that's who goes to war, in Civil War or World War II, that's who you have to recruit because they're the same idiots that drive their cars too fast and spin over in the middle of the night. They're the same idiots that listen to our radio programs. It, you know, those, if you can remind people that even in the Civil War, those teenagers are the same people.
Are the same. Yeah, they had the thoughts, the dreams, the ideology. And yeah, what amazed me about the Civil War documentary is how well spoken these people were. The letters were, "My dear Penelope, I hope this letter finds you in good health." And it's like, Who the hell wrote like that?
Well, it was, you know, they said about the Civil War, it was between the two most literate armies ever to fight. And the whole idea, when you didn't have the internet, when you didn't have TV, when you didn't have radio, you didn't have
Xbox
anything.
Xbox and all these distractions.
You actually learned how to write. You learned how to write, and it became important how you represented yourself, just as how we represent ourselves in the way we dress, the music we listen to, some of the habits that we have. It's no different. It's just in that day and age, it was focused entirely on expression.
On writing.
Articulation.
Because the letters would come out and they'd talk about this death and destruction of so many people so eloquently and make these analogies that are just beautiful and brilliant.
But you know, it's interesting. We just did a thing a month or two ago in Washington, D.C., where we had one of our guys, the fighter pilot. We had a Vietnam vet who'd seen lots of combat, and we'd seen an Iraqi war veteran just back. And as they were talking, you felt like you were watching the grandson, the father, and the grandfather. I mean, they were the same person. And at one, the World War II guy, our guy, says, you know, "I haven't told my son this." And the son was out in the audience. And he begins to tear up. He said, "You know, I've gone to a Redskin game, every home game for the last 50 years. And when the Star-Spangled Banner is playing before the game, I just go through, in my mind, the faces of all my buddies that I lost." And he starts to cry. And the Iraqi guy says, "I feel like I'm an echo of you, and you're an echo of me." It's the same thing. And when you see some of the letters that come back, they're now emails, and moms will always, for as long as they're emails, press print, right?
Oh, and save
on these things and save them. They have that articulation. They don't maybe use the same flourish of language that you do back in the Civil War. But some of the letters, as you know, that we got back from World War II, guys are the same thing. So the impulse is the same. You know, you just want to stay alive, keep your buddies alive, and just figure out some way to deal with this horror that war is.
Do you find it surprising that, because it's one thing that's surprising, but then after you think about it for a while, I guess not. A lot of these old vets from World War II, that emotion is still there and comes out so easily. They can remember the faces of the friends that have died and how they died and the detail. And they just break down a lot of times, and it's heartbreaking. It's just wrenching to watch.
This is the key. Like, we live in this consumer moment, and we're all focused on now. If I just wear the jeans or drive the right car or smell the right, everything will be all right. But memory is not something that's 60 years ago. Memory is something on your hard drive now. So these guys might start off to answer a question that we ask and not know that by the end of it, they'll have access that and be in tears
because just hits them,
it's always right there. And there's a guy who's lived a good life, he's not cuckoo, and his hand shakes almost every morning from remembering that time 63 years ago when he's mowing down Germans and cutting them in half and watching bodies fly in half from his fighter plane. I mean, this is the reality of war, and when you access that, not interested in all that other junk, the context or the, you know, just what it was like to be in battle, then you have an opportunity to sort of be present. Faulkner said, the writer said, "History is not was but is." You know, what does that mean? Except when you watch a guy who, he's 82 years old, but all of a sudden he's not 82, he's 18. And all of a sudden, it's not yesterday, it's now. And you can hear the thrum of the engine. You can hear the bullets. You can see that stuff happen. And that's a great gift when somebody somebody's able to deliver that.
Yeah.
And I mean, we'd hear a guy, you know, like family members sit in when we're doing interviews, and we still shoot films. So every, you know, 12 minutes we change a roll of film. And the greatest sound to my ears is always pop. You told us that. You know, for 60 years, the story of the Battle of the Bulge was, oh, we took over a French farmhouse, they had a wine cellar, we all got drunk. And that was the story. And I'm sure that happened. But what he then tells you is, so it was the coldest winter ever, my buddy was wounded, and in the morning, he was dead. Rigor mortis had set in, and I had to lift his body, stiff as cordwood, and throw it in the back of a flatbed truck. And we found the footage. We spent years in the National Archives.
Wow.
And found that footage. May not have been him doing it, but something so similar that you realize you're there. And all of a sudden, the family's reeling, because for them, Dad's war experience was, you know, and my buddies, and we did this, and here he is, and the bottle of champagne, and the French women. And
here's this horrible moment.
Here's this other also true story. And that's what the book and the film was trying to do, was just get at this intimate details of it, so that it's no longer something that's homework or this distant lesson to us, but something that's personal. We realize that somebody that we know, our dads, my dad, an uncle, a grandpa, went through the same thing, and there, but for the grace of God, I could be there. I mean, I remember when I was 18 and 19 years old, I was wondering what my draft number was for Vietnam, you know?
What was the difference? Because you watched some of that footage in your documentary. It's just fantastic. The spirit of the country and the people that were going off to war, like we said, a lot of these just young kids, but in droves and smiles on their faces. And they wanted to go and do this. And then when they did get there, the amount of camaraderie and bravery, just from, like you said, these ordinary guys, when they're riding home, you know, it's, again, relatable as people that you know and went to school with or worked with. But then as they're doing these things in these moments of terror, you think to yourself, well, there's no way I could ever do that. How did he ever do that?
Who gets that boat at Omaha Beach?
When
LST drops its front down and
ramp comes down, and who is getting off of that and running
and
into machine gun fire?
He's not ending up with an empire at the end.
No, and his letters home weren't, hey, I'm Mr. Brave Guy. It was a scared guy. It was, you know, somebody that, like I said, you worked or went to school with. Where did you find that came from?
A lot of it is just the momentum of the time. When everybody's doing it, there's no way to resist it. Almost in the opening of the film, some guy said, this is just a tide that carried us all downstream, and we were willing to do it. And it wasn't just altruistic patriotism. It was just staying alive, keeping my buddies alive, but participating in an adventure. This is a way to be adult. You know, I could just sign my name, he said, and all of a sudden I'm a submariner. All of a sudden I'm a pilot. All of a sudden I'm the guys I see in the movies.
And not just some kid packing groceries.
Exactly. Mm. You know, pimply-faced kid. He's suddenly, you know, doing that. But then you have to ask yourself, how does this happen? One thing is, it was shared sacrifice. It's a paradox. In shared sacrifice, we made ourselves richer. Today, we're all independent free agents. We walk around. We're not going to give up anything. And yet, we feel that poverty. You know, we have a war going on, but it's fought by a professional class that does all its suffering alone and apart from the rest of us. We're told at 9/11 that the threat was as great as Hitler, but nobody asked us to do anything. They said, go shopping. I mean, if my president had said to me, here are 50 things I need you to give up or to do, everybody in the country would have done that.
Right.
And who knows where we'd be right now. We may not have $3.50 oil, gas. We may not have our bridges and our levees failing.
There were huge sacrifices made during World War II, and people got involved on the civilian front.
And it made us richer. That's the paradox. Not just spiritually richer, we're all together on this, we're all in the same boat, but materially, financially richer. We started off this impoverished country, reeling from the Depression, and 4 years later, we're the richest country on earth, and more than half the manufacturing in the entire world is taking place right here.
Do you find that, like, a lot of the veterans, like, you know, you look at Vietnam vets, and I'm sure even some Iraq vets are very pissed off because the reason they were given or because the way the war was dictated. I'm sure there's a lot of bitterness. Did you find the same bitterness in World War II veterans that I think exists in a lot of guys from Vietnam?
No, it's different. You know, I think with Iraq veterans, you find a variety of opinions politically about the war. A lot of them are against it, but they're doing their duty. I mean, this is the thing. The luxury that we have to have the conversation this morning is because they're men and women who are actually willing to not only fight the good wars, but the bad ones too. Mm. You know, and so there you have a whole range of political opinion among Iraqi vets about how it was. Vietnam was even even more complicated. And of course, the country did not respond well to the soldiers. That's the worst thing we did in Vietnam, is we treated them as if they were the villains, when in fact they were the pawns in a situation in which the country was divided about whether we should be there or not. So it's complicated. The interesting thing about World War II veterans is they just don't want it soft-pedaled. They don't want... I mean, I'm sitting here just over the weekend. Somebody sent me all these responses, just regular letters from folks that came in. And they're saying, you know, snail mail. They're saying, you know, I finally discovered my dad. A veteran came up to me the other day at a book signing, tears streaming down his cheek. He said, you know, I've waited all my life for someone to show it the way it actually was, meaning not soft salt, not John Wayne, not, but the horror of war. And we felt going in, wouldn't it be better to honor them as they are reaching the sunset of their lives by not sugarcoating it, by not draping it in the bloodless gallant myth of all of the cliches that we do about World War II times, but show that this isn't the good war. This is, in fact, the worst war ever. Nearly 60 million people died. How could it be the good war? Now, we know why that comes in, because the country wasn't torn the way we are now or were in Vietnam. But at the same time, nearly 60 million people died. And war is horrible. It isn't like the movie. You get up, I'm going to go and take that machine gun nest, and you get hit and you fall. You're suddenly sitting there, and you turn around, and your buddy doesn't have a head
anymore.
He's
ripped apart.
His entrails are all over. I mean, this is not pleasant things to talk about, but this is what happened, and this is what we tried to honor. And so the veterans, to a person, their anger is about, you know that old thing, Daddy, what'd you do in the war? No one really wants to know the answer to that. No one actually wants to know the real answer to that. And that's why these guys came back and just shut up. And so most of the letters I have are, my dad never talked about it, but I felt through your film and your book that we were able to find out what he did. I now know my dad.
It made a generation of people that were a little set apart from their fathers, not really getting that closeness, and it affected the generations down the line.
Oh, you do. You absolutely know what? It's interesting. What we found is sometimes the grandkids have a better way of prying open.
Yeah.
Granddad than the sons did. I mean, because it's always a complicated dynamic, but at the end of their lives, they've given a different kind of attention to the grandkids. I mean, you know all what it's like with the grand, and we know that there's a complicated dynamic going on between our parents and our grandparents that we don't have with them, and that they're suddenly opening up. So I'm finding grandkids coming to me and saying, this is the memoir that I got my grandpa to do, or I got my DV camera and I was able to record him. And we initiated this thing with the Veterans History Project at the Library of Congress, and we're getting tens of thousands of kids to get their relatives on camera before
they
go.
That's great. I don't think you could have enough information from these people.
You can't have enough. And you feel so great when they download this stuff to you. I mean, as horrible as it sometimes... I remember a woman came up to me and she said, there's a guy on our block. Nobody liked him. He was just a mean old cuss. But I heard he was in the hospital and he didn't have any relatives. Thought, I'll go visit him. So she goes into the hospital. She spends 3 hours and he just starts telling her about these horrible war experiences.
Oh my God.
She said, I didn't know what to do. He died an hour later.
Yeah.
Wow.
So she's now stuck with his nightmare.
Yeah, yeah, right? Yeah.
Wow.
He needed somebody to tell.
Jeffery Ross.
You find that, I mean, my experience from visiting wounded guys is they'll often open up to a stranger. It seems to me that somebody wants to tell, a soldier wants to tell their story, not necessarily right away, not necessarily to their mother or their father, but they want a witness to their history.
I agree. You know, you understand completely why they shut up. Because there's just no things to describe. We form really wonderful relationships in a job like this, in college, in sports, you know, intense relationships with siblings and with parents. But the bonds that you forge in basic training and then in combat are unlike anything else. I mean, the experience of war is, it's a paradox, because when your life is most threatened, you live life at its height. And then you see things and experience things no human being should have to experience. And then you come home and you actually can't tell mom. You can't tell pop. You can't tell your brother. You can't tell your best friend. You left your best friend's arm and body over there.
Yeah.
So you lock it away in the safest, deepest resources of your psyche. But then later on, you do have that impulse. Who can you tell? Who do you speak to? And quite often it's the stranger. I mean, we'd find these guys, we talk to more than 600 people to get the 40 for our film. Most of them couldn't talk about it. One guy we actually, he said, oh yeah, I can talk about it. First question, tears.
Wow.
He couldn't say anything. He was gone. And as you see, a lot of these guys, it's so fascinating, are on the edge of telling you incredible stuff, and you're mesmerized. I mean, I was screening the film early on, and a woman said to me, it's horrible. Don't take out a single dead body. I thought that was really good, you know, that it was sad to one of my daughters, now 21, she was terrified of the vacuum cleaner when she was like one and two. She would run from the room screaming. And one day, the vacuum cleaner's going, my wife has the vacuum cleaner, and she just walks in and sits down on the vacuum cleaner. And that's the way she abolished her fear. And every once in a while,
I still have the fear of vacuum cleaners. Maybe I should try that.
Oh, that really sucks.
No joke. It goes right through me. But Ken Burns in studio, Band of Brothers. What did you think of that?
Loved it. In fact, I think that Saving Private Ryan and Band of Brothers did an amazing thing, which is it said, you know what? Let's just not kid ourselves. War is hell, as Sherman said in the Civil War. Let's just show what it's really like. So that opening sequence of Saving Private Ryan, or a lot of those combat sequences of Band of Brothers, did something that other films hadn't really done before, which is put it in your face.
And when they did the airborne drop in Band of Brothers, it was just, oh my God, who's jumping at it?
So my only thing is, it's just terrific, and we worked with Tom Hanks, you know, who's the voice of Hal McIntosh.
He's been great as far as World War II vets and getting the memorial going.
This thing going about World War II that is so impressive, and he does it really honorably, you know.
Can you believe he was in Bosom Buddies? Can you check? Really?
But now he's doing the Pacific War version of Band of Brothers, and interestingly enough, they're focusing on several of the people that we've already done.
Oh, really?
As live, and I just thought it was incumbent upon us documentary filmmakers. I mean, if you look at the History Channel, it's like, it's called the Hitler Channel.
Yes.
You know what I mean?
The big H in the corner.
They get distracted by those generals.
We thought we were the only ones that called
it the Hitler Channel. Every time you pass by it, it's like, there he is.
Yeah. You know, and you understand it. There is this fascination about absolute pure evil. But there's a problem that happens. That fascination sometimes metastasizes in kind of respect for the Germans' early military successes and their superior weaponry.
They were snappy dressers.
And that's a slippery, slippery slope, you know? And what we thought was, let's go into the, you know, if you're a researcher doing a film, you don't have that much time on the History Channel to spend. You can't spend 5 years in the National Archives as we did.
Right.
You can only take the cream of the crop, which is good stuff. But we were able to find the outs. We were able to find stuff that had been originally shot in color, but it had been made black and white to make a newsreel uniform. But all of a sudden, man, it's real. And so there's stuff that I don't know. I don't care who you are in our film that you look away from. Because
that is amazing, the difference between the black and white film and the color film.
Well,
how you're it makes it more real. It makes it more relatable.
Because we see everything in color now. You don't watch black and white TV anymore.
Yeah, well, black and white is sort of an already stylistic sort of thing that you do in mixed media, you know, an Oliver Stone, a music video. But we for so long, that's how we got all our information about World War II, and that helped to keep it at arm's length.
Distance, definitely.
But all of a sudden, if that guy's coming at you and he's holding his face and it's gushing red blood, it isn't just some dark something on his face, red blood, then all of a sudden that's only one little step and it could be me. And so this is what we try to do, bottom up, intimate.
I got to ask you something about your Civil War documentary. When you had the idea, did people go, hey, crazy, there's no moving pictures from that era.
Yeah.
What are you, insane?
That's exactly it. Well, I started with my dad. I remember I said, he's on Christmas Day in 1984, I said, my next film's going to be on the Civil War. He goes, oh, yeah, really, son? What part? And I said,
the whole thing.
And he looked at me, walked out of the room like my idiot son. But like, I had made 5 or 6 films that were 1 hour, hour and a half in length with still photographs and, you know, a couple Academy Award nominations. And, you know, they were But when I started proposing, it was originally going to be 5 1-hours. They said, nobody's going to watch this for 5 1-hours. And then when I came back halfway through, you know, and, okay, so it's going to be 11 and a half. They just thought I was nuts. And there was this one guy in public television, sort of a mentor, a guy named Ward Chamberlain, who, incidentally, when we'd go out to dinner, he'd get a couple drinks in him. He'd start talking about his time as an ambulance driver in Italy. So I put him in the film. He's in there in the film.
Oh, wow.
Talking about picking up dead bodies in Anzio or in the Monte Cassino campaign. Anyway, you know, he just went and fought the battles with me, and we got it out. But no, nobody thought that. The idea is that the word moving has lots of different meanings, right?
Mm-hmm.
So a photograph may not move, but you can move inside that photograph.
Yep.
And you can create emotional things in which there's apparent movement and there is emotion or movement of another.
You've heard about the Ken Burns effect that people...
Steve Jobs called about 5-6 years ago, and he said, look, we've been perfecting this for a long time, and we called it the Ken Burns effect.
Yeah.
And, you know, it's going to go out in all these things.
It's amazing how you can take a photograph and look at the whole thing, and then as a narrative is going on, slowly... actually pan across the photograph to one person there, and that's who you're talking about.
See, that tells and a story.
It tells a story, and the narrative was amazing. The letters that were being read, amazing. And then I forgot his name, but he had recently passed away.
Shelby Foote.
Yes. Just so unbelievable the knowledge that this guy had.
I made a film on Huey Long, in the mid-80s, and I had interviewed Robert Penn Warren, who'd great poet laureate of the country. He called me up on a hearing I was doing the Civil War and told me, you got to do Shelby Foote. Now, on the bookcase that I was assembling of, you know, all the Civil War literature, he had this three-volume, 3,000-page thing. And I said, okay, well, if Robert Penn Warren says. So we went and interviewed Shelby Foote first. And it was, we didn't need anybody else.
He just, the voice, the whole speaking style he had, just amazing.
Hey,
amazing.
We definitely have to take a break. We have a little more time with you, Ken.
You got me.
Because the phones are late. We'll go to the phones next and continue with Ken Burns, who's The War, the book, the CD, the DVD is all in stores now, right? And you're doing some book signings?
Yeah, I am. We got some Wednesday night. I'll tell you the details. And Friday night, all in Manhattan.
Wednesday, it's at the Borders at the Time Warner Center in Columbus Circle at 7 o'clock right here in Manhattan.
Friday at McNally and Robinson in Soho on Prince Street.
At 7 o'clock.
Yeah, it's been really great to do this.
I bet,
People come up with hand trucks with 20 books and say, Christmas shopping done.
Yeah. So, we'll continue after the break. You just got to promise us that we're not going to have, like, a pop quiz at the end of this.
Oh,
no pop quiz, right?
Hand out
dittos.
Your worksheets.
Everybody remember the smell of dittos?
This is very interesting, but it's bringing me back to school. I'm like, oh, no, we're going to quizzed on this?
Oh, no.
All right, Ken Burns, more with him and Jeffery Ross next. It's Opie and Anthony. You should do a documentary on rock and roll, Ken Burns.
I used to run a record store in the late 60s in Ann Arbor, Michigan. That was a good time to be in Ann Arbor, Michigan.
Yeah?
$5 marijuana law. Like a parking ticket.
Wow, I didn't know that. Are there subjects that you just wouldn't be able to... do a documentary on, or do you pick things that you're passionate about? Or
that's it. That's all it is.
Yeah.
You know, if I were given 1,000 years to live, I wouldn't run out of topics in American history to do. And it's not what you choose; it's how you do it. So in a way, I'm saying I'm making the same film over and over again, just sort of exploring who we are and what we're about. And it's what we were talking about in the break: is that, you know, even the people closest to us remain sort of unknowable and inscrutable, and that's a great, wonderful mystery. You know? I mean, so why do we do biography of other people when we don't even know our brothers or our mothers or our wives or our kids in a complete way? It's just what human beings have to do.
That's so true. I was reading some of the letters that you've been getting because of your documentary, The War, and one of the real common factors in a lot of the letters is the fact that these people that have grown up with their fathers that have went to the that went to just didn't know anything about what he went through until they watched this. And then they said they were crying and couldn't believe, you know, what they were seeing. And it's just amazing that they lived with this person.
That's right.
You know,
didn't know anything beneath the surface.
Mm-hmm.
And that just tells you, you know, what's available. You know, you pass somebody on the street. Who knows what the story? I mean, the way we did this film was to honor the idea. You drive down the interstate and there's that exit. You maybe have passed that town a million times. Well, what if you stopped and went into that town and started asking questions? That's all we did. And within just a few questions, we met people that are as heroic individuals as I've ever met, which tells me that it wasn't just the luck of the four towns that we picked, but the fact that everywhere.
Oh, it could have been any four towns.
Any four towns. It could have been any 40 people who get to go. And remember, these aren't just combat. This is also folks at home. So you get the intimacy of what it was like to worry. Lots of women in this film. One of the stars of the film is Catherine Phillips from Mobile, Alabama, the only person who can take the title of our film and turn it into three syllables. Whoa. And it's an intimate thing. And what we were able to do in the series is give you one thing, and in the book is expand it. So we introduce you to some more people and expand their story in a way a book is able to do.
A very compelling part of the documentary is the soldier that would write home like nothing was wrong.
Nothing was wrong. This is Babe Charlo of Waterbury, Connecticut. You know, his mom, his brothers, his sister, they're all back in Waterbury. And censorship didn't permit him to say exactly where he was or what was going on. Mm-hmm. So, and he didn't want to worry his mom. His dad had passed away a few years before, and she was so anxious about him. So he would write these letters. And at first, when we got them, we thought, oh, no, what are we going to do? There's nothing here. But then we realized
there's so much there.
Knew where he was. So we could show footage of what he was going through the same day he was writing this letter about, oh, man, I'm getting fat. I'm a chow hound. We had pork chops tonight. And you know he's not getting pork chops because he's in the middle of Anzio, and it's just hell. The Germans,
yeah.
Like it was called the largest self-sufficient prisoner of war camp in the world because we couldn't get off the beach. And the Germans had us pinned down for months, and they just rained shells down. And it was just really God's will, whether the bomb landed over there and took you out or landed over here and took me out.
Was he alive, the guy writing those letters?
He I don't want to give it away.
Don't give it away, but it's very, very compelling part of the documentary.
So it's great. So we suddenly realized we got his home movies, we got his family's home movies, we got the home movies from folks in Waterbury. We can show that. But we can also show what's going on the day he's writing the letter where we know mm-hmm. his outfit is in. And it's nothing like what he's describing. So all of a sudden, you realize the love inherent in the lie.
Because how Mom, could you not want to say what's going on and what you're doing? And you know, you don't want to worry your family, but you kind of want to go, Jesus, I'm in hell right now.
I'm in hell right now.
But no, everything's fine.
Everything's fine. Yeah, yeah. I think I'm going to take a swim in the Iranian Sea. It's like, you know, April, you know, and you're going, this guy, the shells are landing around there. Guys are getting purple hearts when they're in the hospital being operated on because the Germans are just bombing the hospitals and everything.
Amazing.
Did I point out what a dope I was, by the way, to ask you just to like blow it by, well, so what finally happened at the end of the movie?
Who done it? Let me
just help you out. We win. I'm sorry. I didn't mean to ruin it for you. And that. But you know what? One of the reasons why we did this was not just that we're losing 1,000 veterans a day, but I heard this statistic in the late 90s that said that an unbelievably large number of graduating high school seniors think we fought with the Germans against the Russians.
Oh, I know. I've read that.
I had to go, oh my God.
Isn't
how is this
amazing?
Possible? You know, that how do we bring up a generation of people for whom
dummies.
the biggest man-made event in the history of humanity, we don't even know the basic ABC of it. Never, let alone the XYZ of it, but the ABC of it. Okay,
yeah.
We fought with the Russians. We're on our side with these people against the Germans. That essential basic fact.
Like, so what lessons can we take away for this war? What can we learn from your movie?
Well, I think there's a couple of things. That we didn't have a political agenda in this film. If you watched any of it, we just wanted to bear witness to the testimony of these people in battle. So the first thing is, we ought to, particularly in a democratic society, know what war is like. Because we have not only the privilege, but the obligation to vote in the leaders who are going to make the decisions whether we go to war. And we ought to be damn sure that the war we're in is a necessary war, which is the first episode title of the war. That was a necessary war. And if you know, as not just as a mother, but as a citizen, what the cost of war is, what it's really like in its interior moments, the stuff that nobody wants to show, then you make decisions. Let's only fight necessary wars. That's the first thing. The second thing is what we were talking about earlier, about shared sacrifice, that if you're going to be in a war, let's do it together. Let's make sure that everybody's willing to participate, to share, to sacrifice, and that there isn't this separate military class fighting and suffering its losses apart and alone from the rest of us. Because I've been traveling around the country for the last year. Everywhere I go, I ask, how many people know someone in Iraq? If it's 1 or 2%, I'm surprised.
Mm-hmm.
You know, outside of a military community. You know, back then, if a hand didn't go up,
yeah,
you were surprised that somebody wasn't engaged in some way. So if this is, as our government keeps telling us, as big a threat now as it was back then, or even if it's half the threat, Why aren't we all doing something every single day to not just support the troops, which is now a cliche, but to do stuff, you know, to pay the higher gas tax or to do without this? All the stuff we did that at the end of the day, at the end of the war, made us richer and better and stronger country. And that's what, you know, the historian Arthur Schlesinger Jr., who passed away a few months ago, was fond of saying there's too much pluribus and not enough unum. The Latin motto of the United States is e pluribus unum, out of many, one. So there is too much pluribus, many, and not enough unum. And I realized when he said that, that all the films I've made, no matter what they were about, baseball, jazz, the Civil War, the West, biographies of Thomas Jefferson or Mark Twain, you know, it's about unum. What is it that we all share in common, not that we're different?
Let's go to the phones here. A lot of people want to get in and talk to Ken Burns. It's Renee in Syracuse. Renee, what's going on?
Hey.
Hi, Renee.
Hi. I am to be able to talk to you guys. Ken, thank you so much. I work for the local PBS station in Syracuse, WCNY.
Thank you very much.
Oh, my God. We are just thrilled that you brought that documentary to PBS. And we had so many calls, and I don't want to take up too much time, but I just would love it to have you come to Syracuse and stop in and talk to people, because so many...
Give them a tote bag?
What's that?
Will you give them a tote bag for a donation?
Of course he was going to bring it to PBS. I don't think MTV was in the running.
But we just want you to know that so many people in Central New York just were so grateful, and so many stories came from that. And I could go on and on. Just, it's been a pleasure listening to everything.
Thank you.
All right, Renee.
Thank you, Renee. That's really, really, really great. We've had a lot of response all around the country, and that's the only thing. And of course, PBS is the only place to do it. No commercial interruption.
Yeah.
And you know, it's sort of much maligned, but we end up making the best science, the best nature, the best public affairs, the best children's, the best arts, all history.
I don't know if you like this or not, but you've kind of made the documentary a little more mainstream than it used to be.
You know what? The word documentary is such a poor word, because it encompasses everything from, like, the political advocacy of a Michael Moore or Morgan Spurlock's type of films, you know, like Supersize Me. You've got Errol Morris's Fog of War, highly beautiful stylized things. Werner Herzog makes documentaries. There's, you know, cinema verite. There's all this different stuff. What happened was is that the Civil War, when it came out, was sort of a watershed moment, and people suddenly looked up. And we're getting tired. You know, Hollywood, you know, when the number one movie's like a third-rate TV show from the 60s, that those forms are a little bit tired. Those plots are a little bit saggy. And that you suddenly turn around and find that in the story of your neighbor, or in the story of, you know, a guy down the block, is as dramatic as anything Hollywood puts out, then I think you begin to realize there's a possibility in documentary.
What's your favorite? Oh, sorry. What's your favorite documentary that you didn't do?
You know, I've seen a lot of one. I love that Fog of War.
Fog of War was amazing.
Fog of War was awesome.
Just about anything that Errol Morris does, I really, really love. You know, I remember early on, I'd seen this film about the Yukon Gold Rush from the National Film Board of Canada, and they had still photographs sort of set up in the scene. And I suddenly had this sort of aha moment of getting inside them. I had originally wanted to be a feature filmmaker. But what I do, and this follows what we were talking about earlier, is I want to treat an old photograph the way a feature filmmaker would a wide shot. That is possible of a close, a medium, an extreme close, a pan, a tilt, a reveal. And I don't just want to look at it. I want to listen to it. You know, are those troops tramping? Are the cannon firing? Are the bayonets clashing?
Well, that's what the amazing part is. If you would have a photograph of a battle sequence, the way the camera's moving on the photograph, the sound effects behind it, you don't need a moving picture.
That's right. Well, this is what we did. There is not one single photograph of battle taken during the Civil War. And yet, it moves because of a really complicated sound effects track, and that's what we also do. And all of that footage from the Second World War comes to us completely silently. None of that stuff was taken with sound. So it was incumbent upon us not just do the tramp, tramp, tramp feet of the Germans marching through Paris, but to add, you know, in some cases, hundreds of effects at any given moment, or sometimes just flies buzzing and water lapping around the debris at a Pacific island after a battle when you see American bodies floating there. That those two effects, the lapping water and the buzzing flies, does it all. Or sometimes it puts you in it And we got to know, what does a German 88 sound fired a half a mile away and right next to you, and what does the shell ejecting, you know, sound like as it hits metal or dirt or snow or mud? And if you put those together, man, that still photograph or that newsreel, that silent newsreel, is suddenly looking like it's happening now. And
it comes to life, absolutely.
Wow, hey, we got Steve who's in the Army. Steve in Jersey, what's up, buddy?
Hey, yeah, I was a Marine. In 03, I went to Iraq. You know, and I just want to thank you guys. I love your show. And I'm really glad that someone's talking about this, because post-traumatic stress disorder, which I have, and a lot of guys I know have, it's just something that most people don't understand.
They don't understand, and we're so grateful for your service. And I think the thing is that, you know, you go into war, and you're a human being. You want to live, and every day you've got this stress that at any moment it might end. Of course you're going to come back and have something. And, you know, we've given a name to it. We didn't have a name back in the Second World War. Mm. And there are exponentially more Second World War veterans suffering than that, only because so many people were in uniform.
Yeah.
It is going to happen when you go to war, because here's the compact, that we turn these young teenagers and 20-somethings into professional killers. Let's not kid ourselves. That's what we're asking them to do. And then when they're brought home or the war's over, you say, okay, don't be a professional killer again. Stop. Stop. I mean, and the momentum of that terror does not stop just because some officer or some piece of paper says it's over. It goes on, and as we know from our World War II guys, it's still there. And the best thing we can do as a country is not be ostriches, bury our heads in the sand and figure out what the next, you know, thing I need to buy in order to be cool is, but to spend a little time with them and just honor it. I mean, whether it's this gentleman who's just called in or our grandpa, whoever mm-hmm. it is, and that's all. It doesn't take any work. It's not homework. This is not obligation.
Yeah.
It just makes good human sense.
We got Janet from Pennsylvania. Janet, what's up?
Hey, I just want to say thank you to the American women and men that are fighting for our freedom. And my dad was in World War II and involved in an incident that was kept top secret by the United States government for 50 years and just started talking about it 10 years ago. He was on a English transport ship that was sunk by the first guided German missile, and more men died on that ship than the Arizona.
And they couldn't talk about it because they were anxious about the technology that the Germans had just unleashed on them.
Absolutely, yep. Absolutely. And the men that died on that ship, their families were not told until 10 years ago that they died on the sinking of that ship. It was the HMT Roma.
Wow.
Rona.
Wow. You know, we find this time and time again. They didn't tell the actual casualties of Pearl Harbor until well after the war, and specifically what ships were lost. And
wow.
And the full extent of it.
Yeah, because who would want that information out there?
They just didn't
there.
Want the enemy
yeah.
to know how successful yeah. it had been. And they, you know, war is about lying.
And we assume, because in this day and age, we get a lot of information very quickly, that the day it happened, everybody knew all the details and what happened, and that's just not the case.
Think
wrong.
About it today. We're not allowed to see, you know, the government's forbidding, as they did in Vietnam in the first go of filming the caskets coming back.
Right.
Something that Americans saw all the time. You'd be, you'd watch cargo ships unload these flag drake caskets in the big netting, you
mm-hmm.
know. People would see on railroad stations this stuff. They'd show that stuff. Roosevelt made the decision to go against the censors and show Americans what the cost of war was at the Battle of Tarawa in late 43. I mean, it was a tough decision. Today, there's nothing. If you want to find out what's going on, you almost feel like a pornographer searching the net. You know, you have to find that stuff, and it's not necessarily coming from an American source or a European source, but often from an Arab source that's gloating over the
sure.
the success mm-hmm. kill. You know, and you know. We're in an age in which we're saturated with media, but we don't necessarily know as much as we.
I think we absolutely should know what the cost is. I think that's common sense.
And yeah. then we honor not only her father, but his service right now. Whether you agree with the war or not,
mm-hmm.
you got to understand that Americans are in harm's way
absolutely.
At this moment.
Phones are lit. One more call, Charlie in Connecticut. What do you got, Charlie?
Hey, man, I just want to say I love the change up to the show. I'm extremely patriotic. I love your views and your innovative ways, Burns. You're awesome. And to Jimmy, man, you're awesome.
Thank
but
you.
I hate your face.
That's very hateable. That's why I do radio, LOL.
Jimmy, you're the man.
Peace. Thanks, buddy.
It says you're reading Ken's book right now?
No, I actually I'm reading it for sociology, and I'm getting through I'm getting through it. I've never read a book in 5 years.
All right. Thank you, Charlie.
Inspiring.
Of course,
people.
He's a fan of mine. Yeah. I haven't read a book in 5 years.
And Jimmy had a book out, so yeah, big happened? Fan you are that you didn't read Jimmy's book.
Oh, man.
That's our music, Ken. We've run out of time, but this was a very interesting hour.
I knew having Ken on would be great. I've been a huge fan, if you may allow me to gloat a little bit and kiss your ass a little bit. I've just been a fan for years, and it's a pleasure to have you on the show.
This has been great. Thank you.
Thank you so much. So it's the war, it's the book, it's the CD, it's the DVD. In stores now, and you're doing a signing here in New York at the Time Warner Center in Columbus Circle. The Borders, this Wednesday at 7 p.m., and then downtown McNally, Robinson Booksellers at 52 Prince Street this Friday at 7 o'clock, right? And you're working on
National Parks, update on the baseball series, history of Prohibition, Vietnam, we're going to start working on.
Oh, wow.
You're insane. And Jeffery Ross,
we're
going to have Jeffery Ross back soon.
Yeah, Jeffery. Sorry, man. You know, come on. Ken Burns, for God's sake. Oh. Yeah, talking to your banana.
All right, Ken Burns, thank you so much.
And you know what, Jeff? The least you could have done while you were here is plug my New Year's Eve show. At the
oh,
North
no.
Theater. What, that's what
oh,
Jeff could have
done? Oh, no. Whore.
What? I just wanted, I was trying to help Jeff out.
I'm going
to
be there.